Hi friends, at DAMS we have introduced a series called as Unplugged, where we try to look at a disease from an integrated perspective. Integrated perspective means that we try to look at disease from various angles and try to find out what is happening, why is happening, so that an undergraduate listening to us forms more concepts. And such concepts are today important for exams like USMLE, AIIMS, NEET. All the exams today are going towards integration. And today I have with me Dr. Pradeep Pawar. He is a leading anatomy faculty and is one of the most followed anatomy persons on social media today.
Thank you.
And today we have selected a very simple topic, because I believe that sometimes you may be a student who is missing out on basic things. So we have selected a very simple topic, very often asked world over. It is like a must-know thing. It is not like anything rare, anything hi-fi, very simple. So let's start with the discussion. So today we are taking a patient who is a newborn with difficulty in breathing, and on examination, one side of the chest is larger than the abdomen, looks caved in. And I know most of you have already formed the diagnosis based on the clinical finding, where you have a scaphoid abdomen with a one side of thorax showing asymmetry and difficulty in breathing in newborn. My goal here is to look at the chest x-ray and to show you how to look at this chest x-ray. I'm sure you can look at on the left thorax in this patient, there are multiple air-filled lucencies, and this appears to push the trachea, and you can make it out through the endotracheal tube to the other side. And if you notice, even the mediastinum is pushed to the other side. You feel that there is some paucity of the bowel loops here, and the bowel loops are appearing continuous towards the left side into the thorax. So these air-filled lucencies, to me, they represent bowel loops. Why? Because I can make out the continuity between the abdominal bowel loops and the thoracic bowel loops, and I cannot make out the diaphragmatic contour, which I am able to make out on the right side. And plus, the left-sidedness also points out to me that, because we know today that the diaphragmatic hernia is more common on the left side, so I am thinking this is maybe a case of congenital diaphragmatic hernia. And I also want you to know, it is always not necessary to have air-filled bowel loops. In a newborn, initially the bowel loops will be fluid-filled and they will look like an opaque hemithorax. And then gradually, when the child gasps, you are able to see the air, and that thorax expands even more and the mediastinal shift happens even more. So this is what we are able to see in this patient on an x-ray. In differential diagnosis, we would have other causes of cystic diseases we can keep, like cystic adenomatoid malformation. But in them, the amount of bowel loops that you see in the abdomen should be normal. There should not be paucity of anything. Here you see a child with caved in abdomen with paucity of bowel loops, and you can even make out the continuity of the bowel loops here. So plus the left-sidedness also tells us about diaphragmatic hernia. Let me ask Dr. Pradeep about why this has happened, and can he help us with the development of diaphragm and why this has happened?
Yeah, hello. So what are the main things which takes part in the formation of diaphragm? The first and the foremost, this is the septum transversum. The main part of the diaphragm is derived from the septum transversum, which is present on the ventral aspect in a developing embryo. The second is, this is the esophagus, and there will be a ventral mesentery for the esophagus and the dorsal mesentery of the esophagus. The dorsal and the ventral mesentery of the esophagus also contributes to the formation of diaphragm. The entire body wall that you're seeing here, this entire body wall takes part in the formation of the diaphragm. Plus, the diaphragm, to begin with, initially the pleural and the peritoneal cavities are continuous with each other. And there's a canal which is known as the pleuroperitoneal canals, and later there's a formation of a membrane here which is known as the pleuroperitoneal membranes, which are going to separate the pleural cavity from the peritoneal cavity, and this pleuroperitoneal membranes also takes part in the formation of diaphragm. To summarize, the diaphragm is derived from the main contribution, septum transversum, the dorsal and the ventral mesentery of the esophagus, the body wall, and the pleuroperitoneal membranes. If this pleuroperitoneal membranes are not formed, there's a posterolateral defect in the development of diaphragm, a posterior and lateral defect, and this is what is known as the Bogdelix hernia.
So Pradeep, I wanted to know, there is a hernia which is present anteriorly as well. So what is the reason for the anterior hernia? Yeah. This is the posterior one, but what is the reason for the anterior hernia?
Anteriorly, we have got this foramen of Morgagni, which is a small defect between the sternal and the costal origins of the diaphragm. The sternal head arises from the xiphoid process and the costal head arises from the ribs. And there's a gap which is known as the foramen of Morgagni, through which the Superior epigastric vessels enters the abdomen. A hernia can occur through this foramen of mock acne.
Okay. So the mock acne hernia is the anterior one, more on the right side, while the mogdalic is the left one, left posterior. And so we have learned a lot from this video with the inputs from Dr. Pradeep, and this is the idea that we had was that, you know, we have seen that sometimes you may end up talking about hi-fi things, but sometimes you may not know the basic development of diaphragm, and it is one of the most important question and probably one of the most often asked in your exam.
Yes.
So please look at this video carefully and understand what has happened and what is the development. They may ask you anything about the development of the diaphragm.
Yeah.
Any particular questions that you want to highlight for the students?
The question just comes on development of diaphragm or mogdalic hernia, or the slides are presented and the visuals are asked on this.
So keep in mind, they can even give you a visual of the entire diaphragm and say which part is developing from which part. This is again a possible question. So this was in a nutshell a case of diaphragmatic hernia and how it develops. Hope you like our effort, and if you like it, please write in the comment section and do follow us on Damzilli channel on YouTube and download the app eMedicos on your mobiles for more such educational videos on the app. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.